There are so many, and I guess, I don't know, I think Hush is a really interesting one to do. There are just, I'll choose Hush. I'll say, well, but that doesn't mean that the next one will be Hush. I just want to say there are so many, and what we would do next, what we're going to do next, if we have that opportunity, is, you know, it's still in the planning stages, and I have a lot of ideas. So please don't latch on to this and say, hey, they're doing the Hush movie.
Hey, this is the Homicide Code Atrocity Podcast. I'm Troy, and we're going to talk about Hush. Now that Matt Reeves has 100% confirmed that Hush will be in the sequel to The Batman, I think that we should take a second to talk about who the character is, why people love him, what comics you might want to read if you are interested, and how this might work in the Matt Reeves Batman universe. All right, let's get into it.
What do you got to do to get comics around this place?
So when people talk about Hush, usually they're talking about one of three stories, or probably interchanging them, as I've noticed a lot of people are doing. See, there's an original Hush story arc that was written by Jeff Loeb and illustrated by Jim Lee. And it was in Batman Comics 608 to 619. And that really is a mystery. The point of that story is it's a mystery as to who Hush even is. But when a lot of people talk about the character, they're actually referencing Heart of Hush, which is Detective Comics 846 to 850, written by Paul Dini and illustrated by Dustin Nguyen. And then a quick follow-up called Hush Money, which is the first story arc of Streets of Gotham.
Your attention, please. An episode.
Hey, your attention, please.
So he's probably not as popular as other villains. That's the reason why so many people are doing these stories about Hush, because you've never heard of him before, unless you've read Batman Comics. See, he's not like Scarecrow or Joker or Bane or any of the other villains that you've seen in Christopher Nolan movies, where everyone has pretty well much a good idea of who they are and what their gimmick is. But he is still super popular when it comes to the comic book fans. And part of that is because of when the first Hush story arc came out, Batman Comics were in a really weird spot. No Man's Land had wrapped up around the end of 1999, and this was about the same time that they ended the Schumacher Batman movies. So Batman wasn't really super popular, and there wasn't any notable comic book story arcs for a few years. Really, comics in general, DC Comics specifically, were not selling unless you were Spider-Man or the X-Men. No one was really picking up your books. And so there wasn't a lot of talent working on these books. 2003, they brought in Jeff Loeb, who had written the longest Halloween trilogy, Longest Halloween, Haunted Night, and Dark Victory. And instead of using his normal partner, Tim Sale, they brought in Jim Lee, who currently is the president of DC. So things really worked out for the guy. Anyways, at the time, though, no one was really talking about Batman Comics, and when they wrote this 12-part mystery story, it really took people. And part of that is because it introduced a new character and didn't tell you who it was right away, where Batman was just genuinely confused.
What does that mean? Why did you say that name?
And you, the reader, were just as confused as he was. See, at first you think that it's Two-Face, then you think that it's Jason Todd, and this was before he was reintroduced as the Red Hood. Then you think it's Clayface, but the whole time you're eating all these bat stories of a new character that's never been introduced before. See, it turns out that Bruce Wayne had a childhood friend named Thomas Elliot, and they had a lot in common. They were both from old money, and they both ended up having parents in terrible accidents. The only difference is Thomas Elliot did it himself. See, he hated his parents. They were not as loving as Martha and Thomas Wayne, and so he cut the brakes to their car. Unfortunately, only his father died. His mother was saved by Bruce's father, Thomas Wayne, who's a world-class surgeon, and Thomas Elliot really never forgave Bruce for this. Unfortunately, the mom, who was wrapped up in bandages and horribly scarred, became the ultimate helicopter mom and never let her son leave her side. And so their paths, although started very similar, diverged in different ways. Whereas Bruce got to travel the world and learn all these things to become Batman, Thomas Elliot, like, had this internal rage, ended up hooking up with a mobster's daughter, and then murdering his own mother.
My mom died. Celebrating.
Fast forward to the events of Hush, and Thomas Elliot uses all the information that he knows about Bruce Wayne after figuring out that he's also Batman with the help of Riddler. He torments Bruce by all the decisions he's made in previous relationships with Catwoman and Talia al Ghul, in previous partnerships with Jason Todd dying, and also other allies as far as like his partnership with Superman and other people who have helped him in previous comic books. But the story, Batman Hush, wraps up in the last issue of you finding out it's Thomas Elliot, and then almost quickly he gets away. The Hush comic book was just this great mystery that brought together the previous 70 years of Batman comics and included all these characters and made fans really feel appreciated. But what you're probably hearing a lot of people talk about are the sequels written by Paul Dini, The Heart of Hush and Hush Money, because those are the sequels that really established who Hush was as a character. And if you don't recognize Paul Dini, you might recognize the Batman animated series. As Paul Dini was a major writer on that before he switched over to writing comic books, specifically Detective Comics. So Heart of Hush is from the perspective of Thomas Elliot after the events of Hush, obviously. And the thing with Heart of Hush is Thomas Elliot being so obsessed with Bruce Wayne, being jealous that Bruce Wayne got to go off and be Batman, builds this psychosis that he needs to become Bruce Wayne. And being a world-class surgeon, he gives himself plastic surgery to look like Bruce Wayne.
You look just like Bruce Wayne. It took time, of course, to find the perfect donors, to graft on the flesh, and finally, to lose myself in order to create this.
And that's what a lot of people, when they talk about Thomas Elliot, refer to that, which is not in the original Hush comic, but in Heart of Hush. And then the follow-up Hush Money, after Bruce Wayne is killed in the event of Final Crisis by Grant Morrison, Thomas Elliot asserts himself as Bruce Wayne in the public eye and is spending his money and is using it to siphon things off. And there's nothing that really heroes can do because A, Dick Grayson's running around as Batman, so it actually provides a bit of a cover. And B, there's really nothing they can do against Bruce Wayne without giving up that Bruce Wayne's supposed to actually be dead. In the end, the outsiders end up stopping him. A board of trustees take the money away from him, and he ends up getting his new face cut off by a villain named Jane Doe.
It uncovered some evidence about some crazy bitch named Jane Doe.
Now, where does that fit in with the Robert Pattinson Batman universe? See, they've tried to do Hush outside of the helmets a couple times. There's the animated movie that wasn't super well received because they removed Hush being Thomas Elliot. That kind of misses the whole point. They made him the Riddler instead.
What do you think of me now?
That you're the same insecure C-lister you were before you went into the Lazarus Pit.
And then they did do a sort of a cameo episode in that TV show Gotham, but Gotham was so weird. So I think that actually Matt Reeves doing Hush is a great way to introduce him in the Batman. The one with the Riddler, the one that came out 2 years ago, was phenomenal. All right, it was an absolute masterpiece. I don't know if it's the best Batman movie, but it is a great movie. But what it did that other movies didn't do was touch on the dark past of Bruce Wayne. And if Riddler can really highlight, you know, Thomas Wayne and some dirty dealings that had happened in the past, and Martha Wayne's psychosis, well, Martha Arkham's psychosis, then I think this is the perfect universe to implement more flashbacks and more story into Bruce Wayne's past. I think they could have Thomas Elliot be the childhood friend that diverges from Bruce Wayne, and I think that this additionally is a great time to introduce the Heart of Hush aspect of the plastic surgery. See, unlike previous versions of a Batman, where they have him as Batman, but they also have him as the billionaire playboy.
The famous Bruce Wayne. Rachel's told me everything about you.
I certainly hope not. So let's put a couple tables together.
I'm not sure that they'll let us.
Oh, they should. I own the place.
This version of Batman is super reclusive, so it would be really easy for somebody who doesn't even look that much like Robert Pattinson to take over his personality in the public eye. And it might make, you know, Robert Pattinson's version of Bruce Wayne have to care about that aspect of his life, which he currently doesn't. But that being said, there's some things I think they definitely shouldn't do, or what I mean is there's things that I don't think the audience should expect. These are the same problems that we've seen in previous movies. See, a few years ago, James Mangold came out with that masterpiece, Logan. And everyone knew that they were going to do the story, Old Man Logan. And everyone also said, there's no way it'll work. You don't have the property rights to Spider-Man, or the Hulk, or Red Skull, or Hawkeye. And those are elements that definitely matter to the story. And then Logan came out and it was fucking amazing. I think the same thing is true here, where the complaints that I've seen online are that you can't do the Hush storyline because you don't have enough characters to do the red herring mystery. Like there's no Poison Ivy or Superman or Jason Todd or Clayface. And I think that those elements don't make the story.
Batman doesn't do ships.
What?
As in relationships.
The other thing is that you shouldn't actually drag out that Thomas Elliot is Hush, because by now everyone has watched my video or other videos or read other articles. Everyone's gonna know it's Thomas Elliot. So the moment you introduce the character, everyone's already know that that's the villain. Instead of doing what the animated movie did and pull out your expectations out from under you, I think they just don't do the mystery at all. Let it be fine that it is Thomas Elliot, and instead touch on those parts of the story that are Bruce Wayne's guilt of letting a friend go wayward, and or how Bruce Wayne feels about being used as a plaything with the personality that he no longer sees as his real life. I think that those elements work. I think the mystery and the several characters are not going to work. Now, all that being said, whatever they do is right.
You know, it's still in the planning stages, and I have a lot of ideas. So
honestly, end of the day, whether they do Hush or don't do Hush, I think that Matt Reeves has a great story in mind, and I think that us, the audience, probably shouldn't go in expecting, or worse, demanding that he do this story or that story or do the character this way or that way. Is what you probably don't remember is the Riddler was only done by Jim Harry before Paul Dino's version, and they're night and day.
Hey guys, thanks for all the comments, and a special thanks to everyone for the tips on detonators.
And I absolutely love what they did in the Batman. So no matter what version they do, I have just absolute faith. So, yeah. That's it. All right. Catch you guys next time. Hush, hush. I thought I heard her calling me now. Hush, hush. She broke my heart, but I love her just the same now. Hush, hush.